Go for it.
Make or escape, you're my own papillon. World turns too fast, feel love before it's gone. Oh, it kicks like a sleep twitch. My papillon, in love and it shone. Darling, now don't put down your guns yet. If there really was a God here, he'd have raised them by now. Now darling, we both get old and die here. Well, that's quiet enough for me. We'll find our own way home somehow. Just a small part to start.
Ah, I'm Michelle. Thank you so much for being here. Michelle's Conversations That Matter.
You're welcome.
I'm so excited that you said yes and that you have given us a song already. I have known you for quite a while now. You were my boss, probably one of my favorite bosses that I ever had the pleasure of working with at J&J. And when I was thinking about topics I wanted to cover in my series, you know, the topic of music always kept coming up because music has the power to invoke so many emotions within us and to, you know, and to like just cause us to express ourselves. Music is such a creative space. So thank you for being here. Can you introduce yourself to the audience? Tell them where you're hailing from and a little bit about you.
Yes. Let me start by saying that I'm 61. So that I'm already close to retirement, but not retired yet. I live in Belgium, which is in the center of Europe. I'm happily married with Veronique, my wife. We have three kids. They're all three adult now. And two of them have grandkids. So we have three grandkids, two boys and one girl. And It's like a cliche to say, but I love them. This is my family is my focus in my life. It's in the center of my life.
Yeah, amazing. I think that when we think about this whole experience of the pandemic, you know, music has a way of pulling people together, especially when there's like a divide going on. There's a divide going on all over, but mainly here. And I think music has a way of sort of bringing people together. Tell us about the role that music has played in your life and why music is so important to you.
Well, I think, first of all, music is like, and maybe it's a cliche that I say, but it's a universal language that brings people together, that connects people. Even if you don't speak the language, if you don't understand each other, there is music. Like Michelle, you were in some of the concerts I was giving during the COVID-19 pandemic, and I played Dutch songs in my language. And even if you didn't understand them, they still were attracted to you, or you were passionate by it, or it hurt you. You felt with it, and you don't even know the words.
Right.
You feel the passion. So I think music has the power to heal us, not only to bring us together, but music has a very healing effect. If I'm in my life, if I was depressed, I used music to heal me. And first of all, I used music to get me more depressed. But I started listening to more depressive music, to dark music. And I was like in my own bubble, all alone with my music. And then I said by myself, okay, now it's time to wake up and to stand up again. And then I started playing happy music, with brightness, and that brought me to where I was. So it's in your life.
Yeah.
When it goes up and down, music is there to go up and down with you.
It invokes emotion. I think, like, if I hear a sentimental song, it just invokes this emotion. And you're right, feelings you might not feel come to the surface, and you sort of feel them through the music. And then you're able to just, you know, release that, whether it's pain or sadness or something. And it sort of serves as a vehicle to help us in many ways.
Well, yesterday I went to a show and with all this Corona and COVID-19 pandemic, the theaters are not doing a good business anymore, because people are afraid to go to a theater. And yesterday there was a show in my hometown made by people who live in poverty. Hmm. Not professionally schooled musicians. And they were with 20, 25 people on stage. And they brought songs about their poverty, about how it is to be poor and how to live in poverty. And one of the songs touched me so hard. And this brings us to the nature of music. And it's about, you can take away everything from me, mm-hmm. but not the music. Yeah. The music will always be, even in my head, it's my thoughts. I will hear the music in my thinking, in my brain. And that was so powerful for me. It was mm-hmm. like, this is all about it.
You know, one of my best memories with you was when you came to the States and you wanted to go to the guitar store. And we went to the guitar store together, right near me. And there you were, just picking up a guitar and just playing in the middle of this beautiful, like, row of, like, guitars. It was great. I mean, good memories there.
Well, it's like, if you look at how music came to me, into my life, there was always music, as long as I can remember. From being a kid, I was raised. My grandmother had a cafe. We call that a cafe in Belgium, mm-hmm. a pub, and it was. There were many pubs at that time in places, mm-hmm. and it was the local people from that street, who lived in that street or a couple of blocks away, who came into that cafe, and when I remember, when I was like 8-9 years old, being in that cafe, they had a jukebox, you know, a jukebox where people put a dime in, mm-hmm. and then they can take a select record. Uh-huh. And that was, for me, that was the music from Frank Sinatra, from Tom Jones, Neil Diamond. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother was always like a little step ahead of everything. So there were also the Beatles and the Stones on that jukebox. And that music was always, it was always part of my life.
Hmm.
It was a tremendous part in my life. And I didn't want to be a professional musician.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question. People don't know this about you, but you've never had any formal training. You taught yourself.
Yes, yeah. I went to music school when I was, I think, 12 years old. And there was a girl sitting next to me, and she fell in love with me, and she asked if we could date. And I was like scared. And I said to my parents, I said, I want to quit music class. So I never finished music class. Mm-hmm. And I started teaching myself music by reading books and learning. I think I played 2 years on my guitar before someone told me that you had to tune it. And once I tuned it, it started to sound like music. Before that, it was like, it was terrible. But nobody knew. And then there was someone special in my life, who is John Micheli. He's an American who lives in my town in Belgium. He's okay. Married a Belgian girl. He came here for business and he stayed here. I think he lives now 35 years in Belgium. And he played in the band that we had. And instead of always going back to the music on books, he told me, he said, hey, listen what you received from life. 2 ears. You have to use them. And you have to start listening to music so that you can hear only the drums, only the bass. Mm-hmm. If you focus and if you focus on that, you can, but you have to learn it, that you can listen only to the guitar. What is the guitar doing? It's doing this and this and this. And then music becomes even more excited because then you hear all these different things in music.
Now, you were in a few bands and you've had a couple of really cool musical experiences. Could you share a little bit about that with us?
Yes, I played in a band called The Firm, named to the movie The Firm, because mm-hmm. we were all in corporate businesses and we were at a certain age, 30, 35, and we played covers. But we still liked the rock and roll part of it. Mm-hmm. So it's the nice guys, but also the rock and roll guys. And we played for... we were asked for to play for the troops,
okay.
Belgian troops in outside Belgium. Hmm. They were located in Lebanon, in Kosovo, and in Afghanistan in Kabul airport. Hmm. And at that time, Kabul airport was, I think, 35 nations were located there. Soldiers of 35 nations were there. And we were asked to play New Year's Eve gig.
Nice.
for the troops there.
Wow.
And for us, it was like, it was an excitement. It was fun until the moment they put on a bulletproof vest. You have to put on a bulletproof vest, a helmet, and they fly you there with a military aircraft. And then it started to realize that this is no fun anymore. This is mm-hmm. real business. And for us, it was like coming into a war zone, because Kabul Air was at that time, ISIS was outside.
Right.
And they hear, because the music that we were playing was in a tent, so they could hear Western music. And
right.
some of the bands before us were even, they were shot at. So we were not shot at. But we played New Year's Eve. We played a gig. We had the confetti, you know, confetti? Confetti. We had this small where people, the party hats.
Yeah.
And we just threw them out to the soldiers. And you have to imagine these soldiers, they are paratroopers. So they are all well-trained, big guys. And when we played a slow song, they were female soldiers at that time. But it was not 50-50. So we saw two male soldiers dancing slow with each other, like if they were with their girlfriend.
Right.
And nobody laughed.
Yeah.
It was because they go to war together.
Yeah.
They also shared this part together.
Yeah.
That moment. And for me, on the stage, that was so powerful to see these hard-trained guys. Being on the slow and dancing, and it was serious business.
Wow!
It was fun. We tried to give them a good ambience, and that's also the healing part of music.
Yeah, I was just gonna say exact perfect example.
Yeah, of what they are away for 3 months from home and their family, and they fly in musicians to give them one good moment, three hours.
Yeah, an experience, an experience away from what they're dealing with.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, music does have the ability to transport you. You know, you close your eyes and hear a song and you're right back where you once were. You know, it's powerful, truly powerful.
Yeah.
So you also jammed in New York City. What was that about?
I was on a business trip. You know, I worked for a couple of corporate companies, big corporate companies, and I had the opportunity to go and visit the U.S. And New York City is one of my favorite places in the world. Mm-hmm. And I stayed at the Hyatt Regency on the other side of the Hudson. So I have a full view on New York City.
Nice.
And they asked me to play a song one evening. They asked me to play a song. And in front of the Twin Towers, well, at that time, there were no Twin Towers anymore. It was only the World Trade Center, the new building.
Yeah.
I played My City of Ruins from Bruce Springsteen as a tribute to all the Americans, but also to everybody who was hit by terrorism. And we in Belgium were also hit by terrorism.
Yeah.
And on that evening, someone asked me, they said, you want to go out in New York City with me? There is, in an Irish pub, there is a sing-along. And I've never been into an Irish sing-along. So I said, that's okay. Let's do this. But tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, I have a presentation to give.
Of course I have to
be back on time. I said, don't worry, trust me. Mm-hmm. So we went to New York City. Mm-hmm. And in one of the subway stations, we had to wait for a connection. And we started jamming, busking. And this was my biggest dream in my life, busking in a New York metro station.
Yes.
And people came there, and everybody was dancing and singing, and it was fun. And when we came into that Irish pub, I have, like I said, I've never been into a sing-along, but this was huge. It was maybe 100 musicians in that pub. You had maybe 70 people playing a guitar, 20 others playing the bagpipes, some playing a violin. And one guy in front, he yelled which song we had to play. But I don't know the Irish songs.
Yeah.
And someone next to me, he just say, oh, don't bother, don't worry. Start in G, now go to the C, back to the G. And so he was giving me what I had to do.
Yeah.
And it felt the energy of these 100 musicians playing one song, every time another song.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody, and it's okay to make a mistake, and it's okay if you don't know the song, we will help you. And if you want to sing, just sing along, whatever you want to do. It was so powerful.
Wow.
But that's the Irish tradition.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
I loved it. And I made it the next day at 10 o'clock, by the way.
You did. Of course you did. So, Patrick, when COVID hit and we were all locked down, tell us about how your Corona concert came to being and what inspired you to do that.
Well, I'm from my nature as a person, I'm a social person. I need social connections. And then suddenly we were in a lockdown. We were not allowed to leave our houses. We were not allowed to see our kids, our grandkids. I couldn't even go to my father, who is 93 years old, and I couldn't visit him. And on one evening I was playing music in my home studio, and I said by myself, well, why shouldn't I open this up and do a live stream on Facebook and let other people enjoy this, because they cannot go to a theater now. So instead of bringing people to the musician, let's bring the musician to the people and bring it to their house, to their living rooms.
Right.
So I started my first live stream on Facebook. And it was such a success that I played 15 weeks in a row.
Wow.
Every Friday evening.
Yeah.
A 1 hour session.
Yeah.
17 songs. That means, and sometimes I played them double, but I think I played almost more than 200 songs.
Mm.
And once I know very well, and the others I don't know very well. It was a little bit, but it was not the quality that mattered.
No.
It was being there.
Yeah.
And I saw during my session, I saw how people connected with each other.
Yeah.
And how they were looking forward to that moment. Not they didn't want to watch TV.
Right.
They say Friday evening, 8:30, it's Patrick's time. We want to be in that Corona house concert. And some people, if they missed it, they sent me a message later on and they said, we watched the day after while we were doing the dishes. Don't worry, we enjoyed it.
Nice. So
I tried to connect people and to give people a good time.
Yeah.
Because I think we need it and we still need it.
Yeah, you had a global impact. I remember attending a few of them. And then you told me this sweet story about a couple who is split up. Tell everyone that story because it was very moving to me.
It's a story about Luke and Linda. And they live in Belgium on the coast. And they have an apartment in the south of Spain.
Mm.
And Luke, the husband, he was in the apartment. I think he was repairing stuff or mm-hmm. whatever. Mm-hmm. And then the lockdown came. And Linda, his wife, was in Belgium. And he was in Spain. And he was not allowed to travel back to Belgium. And Linda was not allowed to travel to Spain. And they watched both my Friday evening concerts. And during that concert, they had connection with them via Zoom and WhatsApp. But they asked songs for me to play for the other.
Aww.
And in that, so I played them. So after 15 concerts, I stopped. I said, okay, give me a break now. Give me some time to. And then suddenly I received this.
Aww.
From Andalusia.
Okay.
From the south of Spain. And it says, it was addressed to me and it says, during so many weeks, you left us on Friday. You let us enjoy on Friday evening. And your music made a very good time for us. We will never forget this. We enjoyed it. Thanks a lot for what you did, Patrick. And that touched me so much. It's and this is all about it.
Yeah.
It's not about making money, making,
yeah,
selling records, whatever.
Yeah.
It's about this.
Connection.
Connection and touching people.
Yeah.
And on a certain moment, Linda was allowed to travel.
Yay.
And she took the bus in Belgium.
Mm-hmm.
And she drove with the bus all the way down to the south of Spain. It took her more than 24 hours to be there,
mm-hmm.
to finally get with her husband. Mm-hmm. By the way, he was infected with corona also. He suffered a lot of corona.
Oof.
And since that moment, because I didn't know the couple.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are connected by Facebook.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we have a connection. And if we have not met each other because of corona again,
mm-hmm.
the moment we met, I think it's as if I know them for years.
3 years. That's amazing. That's amazing. And then, you know, the impact that you've had on people week after week and the consistency, and you're drinking a glass of wine because it's 6 hours ahead and it's your Friday night. So cheers. But then you were also invited to play for seniors. Tell us that story.
In Belgium, the seniors who stayed in a elderly house,
yeah,
they could not receive any visits anymore of their family.
Mm-hmm.
So they were like in custody, and they asked me if I could play for the seniors a gig, but I could not be physically in the elderly house.
Yeah.
So I was outside in their on the in the center of the elderly house
courtyard.
On the courtyard.
Yeah,
I added my amplification,
yeah,
and make sure that, and everybody, they all opened their windows,
mm-hmm.
and they were watching me, and oh. I played typical Flemish songs, Dutch songs that they knew from their childhood, so that mm-hmm. they could sing along,
mm-hmm.
and for me it was such a tragedy. It was like they were captured in prison. And they were like, some people were like waving to me. And I was a couple of yards outside of them, and they were like, it hurt me very much.
Sure.
Impacted me very much. And still, like, you have to imagine, right? Because you're doing these interviews on mental healthness.
Yeah.
My mother-in-law, she's in an elderly house. She's suffering from, how do you call this in English?
Dementia.
Dementia?
Is it dementia? Yeah.
Yeah. And with people with dementia, you have to give them always the same environment and the safe environment.
Yeah.
And we were visiting my mother-in-law every week. And suddenly you're not allowed to visit anymore. But you cannot explain that to those people.
No, yeah.
Because of those coronaviruses outside.
Yeah.
So it is still a big thing, and that's not only in Belgium, because this is a pandemic.
Yes.
That means it's all over the world. I think you in the US are suffering from the same.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, we have to protect our elderly that are vulnerable. And that means, unfortunately, isolation, unfortunately, to keep them well. And it's sad. But I think about the music that you offered them and the joy you brought them in that moment.
The smile on their face.
Yes.
And the, how do you say, the glittering in the eyes?
Yes, yes.
That's what you do it for.
Yeah.
That's what you do it for. And I try to stream it also so that the family could enjoy it as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
I love it, and
all that whole corona pandemic is giving musicians, we have to look to other opportunities instead of, because in the old days it was bring the audience to the musician.
Right.
And now it's bring the musicians to the audience.
The audience.
And there is lots of technology that makes it possible.
Right.
You can stream on Facebook, on YouTube, whatever.
Yeah.
You just and have to do it.
Yeah, for sure. I think there have been a lot of celebrities that have been trying to do something like that, to stay connected to their fans. It's so important. I mean, because you're right, we're not filling stadiums anytime soon, you know? Not happening, for sure.
Nope.
So, Patrick, before we wrap up, tell us, how do people, I'm going to put links in the comments, but people can follow your music on, you said, SoundCloud and YouTube.
Yeah, I have a YouTube channel and a SoundCloud channel page.
Perfect.
Where I upload music. I am recording. I started recording my own music.
Really?
Yeah. Well, when my kids left the house, I said, "It's now or never."
Yeah.
I'll take one of the rooms and make it my own recording room.
Nice.
And so even at 62, it's still young enough to start. Making your first record. So I'm making my own music and recording my own music, and it is on YouTube and on SoundCloud that I release my music, because I don't think it doesn't have to be any commercial for me.
Yeah,
I make music and I want people to enjoy it.
Yeah, and I think it's for you probably just fulfilling to be able to do that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, at the end of the day.
If I can give people a good time with the music I play, because if I have a good time as well.
Yeah.
And if I can have others also a good time and connect people, I'm a happy camper.
Who were the biggest musical influences in your life?
I think the major impact is Bruce Springsteen.
Yes. Okay.
And you're from New Jersey yourself,
yeah.
and for me it was like driving that New Jersey Turnpike. For me, that was something iconic, because Bruce Springsteen was singing about this.
Yeah.
And I started to be in his area, in his neighborhood.
Yeah.
The way he can translate feelings into words and make it a global, that's for me the perfect, like I can name different songs about poor people, about falling in love with the girl you want to take out, go out dancing, have fun, but also the impact of losing your job and work hard. These are the songs that Bruce Springsteen is singing about. So Bruce Springsteen, but next to that, I also have that rock and roll in me.
Yeah.
And then it comes to, for me, the Rolling Stones, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, I very much like. Yeah. And recently, there is this American band that if you don't yet know them, you should start listening to them. They named Black Pumas.
Oh.
And they make this, they make soul music.
Yeah.
In the 2020.
Wow.
But they make soul music and they make influences from Neil Young. You hear guitars from Neil Young, Bruce Springsteen, but then with a soul voice, it's so beautiful. And if I have on one hand Bruce Springsteen, I have on the other hand that little tiny girl called Billie Eilish.
I know, she's amazing.
For me, since like the first time I heard from her, it was like, been there. I know that it's these young guys. Once I had an interview, I saw an interview with her, and she was like, my God, how she makes her music, what she tells in her music.
Yes.
If I start listening to the words she uses, and she produces everything on her own. And yes, this is big music. Yes, this is big money.
Yeah. Yeah.
But for me, she's a great artist.
Yeah. I'm a fan.
I love her. Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
With the green hair.
Yeah.
My kids come home at that time with green hair, I would say. But Billie Eilish, yes, I love her. I love her a lot. Yeah.
All right, Patrick. Thank you so much for joining us. You want to play us out?
Yes, I'm going to play, if it's okay with you, I'm going to play two songs for you.
Yay. Thank you.
And the first song, it's a Bruce Springsteen song, and it's specially dedicated to you, Michelle, because when we were professionally together, connected, I spent a lot of my time in New Jersey area.
Yeah.
And we were going to restaurants. You learned me restaurants in New Jersey.
Yeah.
You learned me the music shops with Eddie and stuff like that. So this song is dedicated to you.
Awesome.
Is my guitar on?
It's on.
I got no time for the corner boys down the street making all that noise. Don't want a horse on 8th Avenue, 'cause tonight I'm gonna be with you. 'Cause tonight I'm gonna take that ride, cross the river to the Jersey side, take my baby to the carnival, and I'll take her on all the rides. On the shore everything's alright, you with your baby on a Saturday night. Don't you know my dreams come true when I'm walking down the streets with you, singing sha la la.
Shalalala. Shalalala, love, with a Jersey girl singing shalalala. Shalalala. Shalala, 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 with a love, with a Jersey girl. You know she thrills me with all her charms. When I wrapped up in my baby's arms, my little angel gives me everything. I know someday she'll wear my ring. So don't bother me, cause I have no time. I'm on my way to see that girl of mine. Nothing matters in this old wide world. You're in love with a Jersey girl singing sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la, sha-la-la. Oh, I've been in love with a Jersey girl singing sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la.
Woo!
Thank you! Thank you! I want to close with an Italian song.
Nice.
It's an Italian traditional. I always played this song to end my Corona House Chamber concerts. It's a song which is sung by Italian people to support all people in healthcare who helped us getting through the corona.
Mm.
The song is called Bella Ciao. It's an Italian traditional song about fighting for to survive. Stamattina mi sono alzato. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Stamattina mi sono alzato. L'impazzo e partigiano, portami via. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Partigiano, portami via, che mi sento di morire. E partigiano, portami via, che mi sento di morire. Sei un buio partigiano. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Sei un buio a partigiano, tu mi devi porre. Seppellire sulla montagna. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Seppellire sulla montagna, sotto l'ombra un bel fiore. Seppellire sulla montagna, sotto l'ombra un bel fiore. E le genti che passeranno. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. E le genti che passeranno. And I want to dedicate this song to all people in the world who are hit by this corona, and to give them a big support and to say
just have to carry on.
Yep.
Keep that distance, wear a face mask, and disinfect your hands.
Yep.
And don't kiss each other too much, except when you're in love.
Yeah.
Rest of the day. Yeah. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Questo fiore del partigiano, morto per la libertà. Questo fiore del partigiano, morto per la libertà.
Patrick, thank you so much. That was so awesome. Thank you so much.
And by the way,
yeah,
I love that puppy.
This guy?
Yeah, I think it's his name.
Teddy. Thank you so much for being here. Thanks for sharing your story. And thank you for always creating music and helping people heal. I think it's amazing what you're doing. And I know we'll stay in touch. Thank you.
Of course.
All right, my friend. Have a good night.
Take care. Have a good night. Bye-bye.
Bye.